زال والكسالى إنه نور تجلى ربنا الله تعالى زال القرآن حقا ويقينا لي وسحقا للأباطيل وفرقا ساقا.
وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لا تزال طائفة من أمتي يقاتلون على الحق لا يضرهم من خذلهم حتى تقوم الساعة. وفي رواية لا تزال طائفة من أمتي منصورين على الحق لا يضرهم من ناورهم حتى يقاتل آخرهم المسيح الدجال. صدق الله العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الأمي الكريم ونحن على ذلك لمن الشاهدين والشاكرين والحمد لله رب العالمين. اللهم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. سبحانك لا علم لنا الا ما علمتنا انك انت العليم الحكيم. اللهم انفعنا بما علمتنا وعلمنا ما ينفعنا. ان الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا ايها الذين امنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى اله واصحابه واتباعه وازواجه وذرياته. Respected brothers, ulama and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah, it's an honor to be here again, mashallah, to see the lovely brothers' faces again, alhamdulillah. And I make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He gives us the ability and tawfiq to act upon what is going to be said, inshallah. May Allah accept this gathering of ours today, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make this a means of attaining His eternal pleasure in the hereafter. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make this gathering of ours a means of removing the sufferings of the Muslim Ummah at this current time. Now, brothers, we need to go back into the life of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and go to the life of Umar bin Khattab radiallahu anhu. Umar radiallahu anhu, he mentions that upon occasion we were sitting with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and this was a normal occasion where we used to benefit from the teachings and the statements of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But on this particular occasion, something strange happened. And what happened? Umar radiallahu anhu says that whilst we were sitting with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, اِطَلَعَ عَلَيْنَا رَجُلٌ, a man entered the gathering, and as he entered the gathering, the physical features of this man were slightly strange. Because number one, I have never ever seen this man in Medina Munawwara before. Number two, there was no signs on this man that he is from the local community because I didn't recognize him. And number three, something which was even more strange was that in those days, if somebody was to travel from one city to another city, one town to another town, then there would be some physical aspects or effects of that journey on that person. But when we were looking at this person, there was no signs of any difficulty or signs of journey that he has undertaken on his body, which made it even more strange. He says this man came right in front of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and فَأَسْنَدَ رُكْبَتَيْهِ إِلَىٰ رُكْبَتَيْهِ, he sat so close that his knees were touching the knees of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was in the tashahud position. And he said, Ya Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, O Muhammad, explain to me, or can you answer these questions of mine? Now Umar radiallahu anhu says, which was even more amazing, is the fact that he actually had the courage of naming and saying, O Muhammad, whereas we people would say, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which made it even more strange. So this man enters, he sits in front of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he asks a few questions from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This hadith and this narration is known as the hadith of Jibreel alayhi salam. This man who had entered upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came in the physical aspect of a human being, but was none other than Jibreel alayhi salam. Umar radiallahu anhu says that he asked five questions from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And after asking these questions, when the Messenger of Allah would answer, he would say, Sadaqta, you have spoken the truth. And this amazed us. Why? Because prior to knowing that this is Jibreel alayhi salam, nobody had the courage of actually asking questions from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam directly. And on top of this, after answering and saying you have spoken the truth, a human being cannot do this to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now from those five questions, one important question that Jibreel alayhi salam asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was, he said, tell me, when is Qiyamah going to take place? When is Qiyamah going to take place? Now this hadith which I've narrated, ulama mentioned, Allama Shabir Ahmad Uthmani rahmatullah alayhi, who was a great scholar of Pakistani origin and who did a lot of work in regards to creating Pakistan, he mentions in regards to this hadith, he says that this hadith or this incident took place 80 days just before the demise of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this is a very important incident for the Sahaba, for the Muslims and for people like me and you. So he says that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asked a question, tell me, explain to me when Qiyamah will take place. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he answered and he said, وَلْ مَسْئُولُ عَنْهَا بِأَعْلَمْ مِنَ السَّائِلِ أَوْ كَمَا قَالَ, that the one who is being questioned has no more knowledge than the one who is asking the question. I do not know. The one who is being questioned does not know more than the one who is asking the question. So then Jibreel alayhi salam asked the Messenger of Allah, he said, tell me an amaratiha, tell me about the signs of Qiyamah. Tell me some signs in regards to the Qiyamah. What do we learn first of all from this hadith, my brothers and sisters? Number one, that not only is it part and parcel of our religion of Islam to know about our salah, about our zakah, about our belief in Allah, as well as knowing about these aspects of Islam, it is as important to know about the signs of Qiyamah and know those things which run up to the Day of Judgment as well. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asked the question, can you explain to me the signs of Qiyamah? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not say, like we hear from some individuals in this day and age, bro, brother, don't worry, it's very far off. And we do not hear, as we hear from people today who say, you know what, there's no need to get into these delicate issues, just carry on worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and everything will fall in its place. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not say to Jibreel alayhi wa sallam, don't ask this question, it's very far off from where you are asking. Let's talk about something else. What did the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say? He said, I do not have more knowledge than the one who is asking a question. When he asked him, show me, tell me the signs, even then the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he could have said, leave it alone, or let's put this aside, let's talk about salah, let's talk about zakah, let's talk about something else. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explained in detail the signs of Qiyamah. Now today's topic is related to Imam Mahdi. But leading up to Imam Mahdi, what we need to understand and know in our religion is there are certain signs and indications from the words of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam which he taught us and told us to learn and understand, that will make us realize and know that we are heading towards Qiyamah and we are moving further away from the blessed era of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explained, he said, you want to know the signs of Qiyamah? Then antalida al-amatu rabbataha. He said, one of the signs, you will see that a slave girl will give birth to her master. The ulama mentioned different interpretations in regard to this hadith. Two meanings they give. They say one meaning of this hadith is that there will be many battles and wars taking place near the end of times, because of which a warrior will go in battle, he will capture a slave girl, and that slave girl will give birth to the child of that fighter or that warrior. And what will happen? That child, that son or that daughter will end up becoming the master of that slave girl. Now when we contrast this hadith in our day and age, it becomes very, very easy and straightforward. Iraq, Afghanistan, Syria, Lebanon, Libya, Muslim countries, one after the other, we see the situation of the Muslims. That every single Muslim country which we are know of, either it is involved inside war, or if it's not involved in war, then there are plans, and there are plans from the side of the enemy which are trying to overtake these Muslim countries. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explained that the slave girl will give birth to her master. Another meaning that the ulama mentioned, they say that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was referring to children disobeying their parents. And we see this in our day and age. Children have no consideration towards their parents. And going a step forward, some parents, they have 5, 6, 7, 8, mashallah, 10 children, but not even one child is worthy of being called a child. All of their 10 children, all of them 7 children that he has, they are like animals in the form of human beings. And this is what we are seeing, that the children become disobedient towards their parents. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam explained in another narration that he said, "La yazdad al-amru illa shidda," that the dunya and the situation of the dunya will only increase in severity and in difficulty. From the demise of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we see that the Sahaba radiyallahu anhum, after the Messenger of Allah passed away, from that moment onwards, they saw difficulty after difficulty after difficulty. Anas radiyallahu anhu, there is a narration mentioning Bukhari that Anas radiyallahu anhu was approached by one of his students, Zubair bin Adi rahimahullah, a tabi'i, and he says, "Shakona ila Anas ibn Malik." We came to Anas bin Malik radiyallahu anhu. This is just after the demise of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We came to him and we complained to him min amril Hajjaj. We complained to him about Hajjaj bin Yusuf, who was the greatest tyrant, or one of the greatest tyrants at that time, against the Muslims, who was from Iraq. And they complained to Anas bin Malik. They said, "You know, this man is giving us a lot of problems and difficulties." Anas radiallahu anhu said, "Isbiru, have patience." You know why? Because I heard from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that every single day or every single year that passes by, difficulty and difficulty will be faced by the Ummah, and the situation will only increase in regards to trials and tribulations. Now we look at the Muslims and how is our situation? Unfortunately, no way Quran is being burnt. In England, you can't even go to a shopping center dressed as a Muslim, except that everybody starts looking at you with eyes. Not only non-Muslims, even your own Muslim people start looking at you. Okay, where does he come from? Is he from Mars or is he from a different country? Why? Because of the modernism that has struck the Muslims at this current time period. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "A time will come upon the Muslims where holding on to the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be like holding on to a coal or a burning hot ember. Just as a person cannot be able to bear that heat and the intensity of that coal, in the same way Muslims, it will be difficult for them to hold on to the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala." Nowadays in England, which many people do not know or are unaware of, is the Schedule 7 anti-terrorism law, where Muslims, if you leave the country for whatever reason, the government has the right to stop and search you without any allegations against you or your children, your wife, your family members. Without any right, they have the right to stop you, search you and detain you for over about 5-6 hours. If this isn't musibat and trials, then what is, my friends? And you know, by Allah, those brothers who travel and they do get stopped, if you ask them, how do you feel? You know, those brothers who get stopped and searched for no reason, some people say, "You know what, you have to follow the law of United Kingdom, you have to obey the law." Nobody is disregarding this, but there's no need for these harsh treatments with the Muslims. The report was released recently that approximately for 20 years this law has been passed. And I don't know, Allah knows best, there might be brothers here who have been stopped by Prevent or by the government, either leaving UK or on their return. And you know how difficult it is. A brother I spoke to, you were saying, it feels like they strip you naked, and the way they ask you questions, you feel humiliated. And this is trial and musibat. This is a difficulty upon the Muslim Ummah. And you know, personally, I was mentioned to a brother recently, we went to Turkey with Ummah Welfare Trust. On my return, I also got stopped. And I was mentioned to the brothers that if it wasn't for the strong faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and knowing the deen of Allah, even though it is maybe a 5, 10, 15%, knowing the deen of Allah prevented me from leaving the fold of Islam. Otherwise, I actually felt after that interrogation that there is no need to be dressed like this, I should just behave like the non-Muslims. And this is a musibah and a difficulty that is coming upon the Muslims. Things will keep on getting even more difficulty. The hadith which I narrated in the khutbah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what did he say? He said, "Yanzilu bi ummati bala'un shadeed." On my ummah, bala'un shadeed, a lot of difficulties will descend upon the ummah. In regards to your beard, in regards to your thobe, in regards to the way you dress, in regards to you going to the masjid, in regards to teaching your children the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So many brothers and so many individuals have programs where their children are being taken away from them. Why? Simply because they take them to a madrasa or because they have concern in regards to their deen. These difficulties are coming upon us, my friends, and the situation will only increase. But one question I want to ask you is, what are we doing in regards to our deen? And what are we doing in regards to combating this issue? Are we just sitting there and saying, you know what, let's just go through the musibat and ignore it? Or are we sitting there and saying, it's all the Muslims' problem, it's their fault, it's those people who are doing it. It's the mullahs, the mulvis, the sheikhs, it is their problem, it is because of them that we are going through this difficulty. We need to ask ourselves. And the third thing is, if I have knowledge and if I have understanding about the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how much am I helping my Muslim community in combating this issue? The answer is very simple. Many of us have no consideration in regards to this. You know why? Because it's not happened to me. It's not happened to me. You know, if I ask you, my friends, imagine you are traveling with your wife or your children and you're leaving the country, and all of a sudden they put your wife to a side and they put you to a side and they tell your wife your husband is going to be locked up for 25 years. How would you feel? How would your wife feel? But because it's not happened to you, we have no care and concern. The Muslim Ummah is such that if a person is dying on the other side of the world, if a Muslim brother of ours, a sister is in pain or difficulty, the condition of a Muslim should be such that he should have sleepless nights. And if he can't have sleepless nights, then he should bear that pain inside his heart that I wish I could do something in sorting this problem out. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Bala'un shadeed." Trials and tribulations will come upon this Ummah. Then what will happen? فَيَبْعَثُ اللَّهُ رَجُلًا مِنْ إِتْرَتِي. The talk of today, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send a man from my family. Allahu Akbar. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said a narration, a hadith, that لَنْ تُهْلَكْ أُمَّةٌ, that nation can never be destroyed. أَنَا فِي أَوَّلِهَا, that I am in the beginning of that nation. وَإِيسَى بْنُ مَرْيَمْ فِي آخِرِهَا, and Isa the son of Maryam alayhi salam, he is at the end of that nation. And وَالْمَهْدِ فِي وَسَطِهَا, and Mahdi is in the middle of that nation. That nation can never be destroyed. That nation can never be destroyed. Muhammad is the flag bearer. Isa alayhi salam carries that flag of Muhammad. And in the middle we have Imam Mahdi. That nation can never be destroyed with the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But again I ask you, where does that leave people like me and you? How much have we done for our deen? So much inconsideration, so much negligence towards the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wishes, He will send a man from my family. And what will he do? فَيَمْلَهُ الْأَرْضَ قِسْطًا, he will fill the earth with peace and justice. كَمَا مُلِئَتْ ظُلْمًا وَجَوْرًا, just as the dunya was filled with oppression and with oppression, trials and tribulations, difficulties, he will remove this and he will bring about peace throughout the whole world. He will bring peace throughout the whole world. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Hassan radiallahu anhu, as well as Ali radiallahu anhu, narrating this hadith, upon occasion he was sitting with his son Hassan radiallahu anhu. And whilst he was seated with him, he turned to the gathering and he said to the gathering, he said, listen, inna ibni hada sayyidun, that this child of mine, he is a sayyid, he is a leader. He is the leader not only in the dunya but in Jannah as well. Sayyidun kama sammahu Nabiyyu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He is a leader in the dunya and in the akhirah, just as the Messenger of Allah mentioned. And then he said, وَسَيُخْرَجُ وَسَيَخْرُجُ مِنْ سُلْبِهِ رَجُلٌ, a man will come out from the progeny of Hassan, my child, from his progeny. A man will come. And what will he do? He will fill the earth with justice, just as it was filled with zulm and oppression. Upon occasion, Abdullah bin Amr bin As radiallahu anhu says that his students mentioned that he was sitting with us and he mentioned the arrival of Imam Mahdi. And he said, Imam Mahdi radiallahu anhu, he will arrive from the east. And when he will arrive, لَوِسْتَقْبَلَهُ الْجِبَالِ, if the mountain was to confront Imam Mahdi, then he will tear this mountain apart and he will make roads and pathways through this mountain to reach his objective. Who is Imam Mahdi? Imam Mahdi, his name will be Muhammad. Similar to the name of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that if there was only one day left in this dunya, and only in that one day Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had decreed that this is only one day left for the livelihood of mankind, then what will happen? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will stretch that one day until He sends a man from my family who will fill the earth with justice, just as the earth was filled with zulm and oppression. Meaning that Qiyamah can never take place until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not send a man from the family of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, I was mentioning yesterday in a talk in Hal that last week on the 20th of November, there was a group of individuals in 1979 who claimed, one of them claimed to actually be Imam Mahdi. And what he did was, he took over the Haramain, he took over Makkatul Mukarramah, and they tried to take over Medina Munawwara. And the man, his name was Juhayman or Juhaymin. And he took over with AK-47s and he took over the whole of the Kaaba, and many, many people, approximately 400 people were injured and about 120 people died. And what was his claim? He said that, "I am Imam Mahdi, everybody start giving your pledge of allegiance to me." What he doesn't realize is, this fool, that Imam Mahdi will not realize and know himself that he is Imam Mahdi until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not inspire him in one night. And Imam Mahdi, when he arrives, he will not force people to follow him, rather the hearts of people will fall towards Imam Mahdi. Just recently as well, many brothers might have seen this, there was a guy who came on TV and he said, "I am Imam Mahdi." And the brother asked him and he said, "Okay, can you speak Arabic?" And he said, "Yes." And he said, "Okay, go ahead." And he started reading Suratul Fatiha. And even Suratul Fatiha without any tajweed. And the brother said, "Listen, you've shamed yourself enough, go back and sit down in your chair." There will be many people who have claimed or will claim to be Imam Mahdi, but we have to remember one thing, my friends. Imam Mahdi will not claim this himself until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inspires him, and the friends of Allah in that time, they do not recognize him and give him pledge of allegiance on his hands. Now, one thing I want to clarify, which many Muslims maybe do not know. Some people think Imam Mahdi will have a briefcase in his hand and he will wear a suit on with a tie, and he'll be from a university in England, and he will go to the United Nations and he'll start putting on the trousers of whoever the general secretary is at the time and say, "Please have mercy on the Muslims." One thing we need to understand and know, that Imam Mahdi, he is connected with that shu'bah and that category of Islam which is known as the Mujahideen and the fighters in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's not connected to anybody else. Anybody tells you anything else, then that person is delusional and he has no understanding of the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, this is an authentic hadith. This hadith is, in the science of hadith, has reached the level of tawatur. Tawatur means that in every age, amongst the sahaba, tabi'een, tabu tabi'een, this narration was narrated to such a level that a person with his intellect, it is impossible for him to conceive and understand that every single group of every era, they made this hadith up and they lied amongst themselves. It's impossible. What did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam say? He said, "La tazalu ta'ifatun min ummati yuqatiluna 'ala al-haq." There will continuously remain one jama'at, one group, who will continuously fight in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Fighting doesn't mean that you eat an ice cream and you're sitting at home. Or you're sitting at home and you make a YouTube video and you have your YouTube channel and you're telling everyone, "Brother, I'm doing jihad fi sabilillah." Or you're sitting in the corner of a masjid and people are coming and learning Quran tajweed from you, "Brother, I'm doing jihad fi sabilillah." Or you're sitting at home and you've learned a few akhi akhi words of Arabic and you're saying, "Brother, I'm doing jihad fi sabilillah." Jihad fi sabilillah means qital fi sabilillah, and that is connected with those individuals who are fighting the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Anybody tells you anything else, he is a liar and the brother of Dajjal. This hadith has been mentioned by many, many companions, that the one group will remain till Qiyamah, who will fight upon Haq. They will not be bothered. لَا يَضُرُّهُمْ مَنْ خَذَ لَهُمْ. They will not care in the least whoever leaves them alone or whoever bothers them and shows them hatred. Then what did the Messenger of Allah say at the end? حَتَّى يُقَاتِلَ آخِرُهُمْ. Until the last one of them will kill Masih al-Dajjal, who will kill Dajjal, the greatest liar. I ask you a very simple question, who is going to kill Dajjal? Let's see, mashallah, brothers know. Isa alayhi salam. So Isa alayhi salam, I thought somebody might say Boris Johnson. So Isa alayhi salam, he is linked to which group? He is linked to that group which will be fighting in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what the meaning of the message of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why? What did the message of Allah say? Until the last one of them kills Dajjal. And you know, I was mentioning yesterday as well that there was an incident in the time of the companions. There was a small Jewish boy that was born in Medina Munawwara. And in Mishkatul Masabi, a book on hadith with many narrations, there's actually a chapter with many narrations in regards to many companions thinking that this child who was born, he is actually Dajjal himself, born in the time of the Messenger of Allah. And there was an incident which took place where the Messenger of Allah traveled to the location of this Jewish child, and he went to see the affairs and to find out if this is the actual child who will later on become Dajjal. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went with Umar and a few other Sahaba. He hid behind a tree, and when he hid behind a tree, he was watching that child and he was muttering and saying things under his breath. And whilst he was talking to himself, the Messenger of Allah was there and he was trying to listen. And all of a sudden, the mother of that child, she came out and she saw the Messenger of Allah hiding behind that tree, date palm tree. And she said to her child that, get up, Abul Qasim, meaning the Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he's here, come and meet him. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that, you know, Waylak, or you know, may she be destroyed, is an Arabic phrase what they use. That if she stayed quiet, I would have found out if this child is actually Dajjal. Now Umar radiallahu anhu was with the Messenger of Allah and he said, oh Messenger of Allah, give me permission, let me cut his head off. Because if he is Dajjal, Muslims will be saved from the fitna. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said there and then, he said, listen, O Umar, if he actually is Dajjal, then Allah will not give you the power to kill him. Why? Because he is going to be killed by Isa ibn Maryam, the Isa alayhi salam. And if he isn't Dajjal, then why are you going to kill an innocent child for no reason? And then Umar radiallahu anhu remained quiet. So the job of Isa alayhi salam to come in this dunya is actually to kill Dajjal and finish off Dajjal and the fitna that he has brought. So coming back to Imam Mahdi. Imam Mahdi, his name is, what did I mention his name is? Muhammad. His name will be similar to the name of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His mother's name will be Amina and his father's name will be Abdullah, similar to the family of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In Abu Dawood, there is a narration where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Yushbihu bi khuluqi. He said that he will be similar to my akhlaq and my mannerism, my characteristics, but he will not be similar in regards to the physical aspect of me. In another narration, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, he will have a big forehead, a large forehead, which is a sign of intellect and intelligence, and he'll have a short or a small thin nose. And his name will be similar to my name, and his family, he will be linked to the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The narration which I mentioned to you, Abdullah bin Amr bin As radiallahu anhu says that when Imam Mahdi will arrive from the east, he will, even if a mountain is to come in front of him, he will tear this mountain apart and he will carry on with his objective. Abdullah bin Amr bin As radiallahu anhu says he will be from the progeny of Hussein radiallahu anhu. Now there's an apparent contradiction. Is he from Hassan or is he from Hussein? And this is why many other sects out of Islam, as well as inside Islam, they use these narrations to try and prove that there's no such thing as Imam Mahdi. The Aqeedah of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah is that Imam Mahdi is going to come, and if a person rejects the existence or emergence of Imam Mahdi, then this will take him out of the fold of Islam. You know why? Because he has rejected those ahadith which have mentioned the emergence of Imam Mahdi. And those hadiths which mention the emergence of Imam Mahdi, approximately there is 90 narrations which talk about the emergence of Imam Mahdi. The ulama mentioned a person rejects a hadith which is tawatur, then it is like rejecting a verse of the Quran Kareem. And a person who rejects the verse of the Quran Kareem, automatically he gets out of the fold of Islam. Now as I was mentioning, there is a contradiction. Is he from Hassan or is he from Hussein? Ibn al-Qayyim Jawzi rahmatullahi alayhi gives a very beautiful explanation in regards to this. He says that there's no contradiction in the hadith. Abdullah bin Amr bin As is correct, as well as Ali bin Abi Talib is also correct. He will be from Hassan, he will be from Hussein. His father will be from the lineage of Hassan radiallahu anhu, and his mother's side will be from the lineage of Hussein radiallahu anhu. So that will make him a Hassani and a Husseini, meaning he has the full family of the Messenger of Allah inside his lineage. And Ibn al-Qayyim Jawzi rahmatullah mentions something even more beautiful. You know what he says? He says that Is everyone still with me? He says, Ibn Qayyim Jawzi rahmatullahi says that the reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make him from the progeny of Hassan radiallahu anh, there is a small little subtle point. When Muawiyah radiallahu anh and Hassan, they met each other, and there was a big issue in regards to this, where Muawiyah radiallahu anh was the Khalifa, and thereafter once Hussein was martyred, then many people wanted Hassan radiallahu anh to become the Khalifa, and he remained the Khalifa for 6 months. And after 6 months, Hassan radiallahu anh, he met with Muawiyah and he handed over the Khilafah to Muawiyah radiallahu anh. And the Messenger of Allah prophesied this many, many years before. And he said that Hassan is a Sayyid, he is a leader. And from Hassan, I have hope in Allah. Very, very soon, Allah will use Hassan to unite two group of Muslims to become one. And this is what happened. Hassan radiallahu anhu, he gave the Khilafah to Muawiyah, and Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, for 20 years he ruled over the Muslims without any problems or difficulties. Now, Allama Ibn Qayyim Jawzi rahmatullahi, you know what he says? He says that Imam Mahdi is going to be from the progeny of Hassan. You know why? Because Hassan handed over the Khilafah to Muawiyah radiallahu anhu. For whose sake? Not for anybody's sake apart from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because he did it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ibn Qayyim Jawzi mentions, he says, مَنْ تَرَكَ شَيْئًا لِوَجْهِ اللَّهِ أَعْطَاهُ اللَّهُ أَوْ أَعْطَى ذُرِّيَّتَهُ أَفْضَلَ مِنْهُ. Whoever leaves something for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah will definitely give him something even better than what he had. And if he doesn't give it to him, he will grant it to his children. Imam Mahdi is from the children of Hassan radiallahu anhu. So he will take the Khilafah, and Ibn Qayyim Jawzi says the Khilafah Imam Mahdi is going to be such a Khilafah that Mawlana Idris Khan Dalvi Sahib Rahmatullahi, who was a great scholar of the Indian subcontinent, he says the Khilafah of Imam Mahdi will be just as great as the Khilafah of Abu Bakr and Umar radiallahu anhumah. So imagine the great Khilafah of Imam Mahdi. So when he will arrive, how will Imam Mahdi arrive? When he reaches the age of 40, Imam Mahdi, as I mentioned, he's not going to be born in America or England. He's not going to be born, unfortunately, in Scunthorpe or Birmingham or London. And he's not going to graduate from Oxford or Cambridge University. He's going to be born in Medina Munawwara. When he's born in Medina Munawwara, when he reaches the age of 40, Umm Salama radiallahu anha, she mentioned that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that when he reaches the age of 40, at that time in the Arabian Peninsula, there will be an ikhtilaf between two sons or three sons. When their father will die, the king will die, there will be an ikhtilaf amongst the children. Some people are actually saying that MBS in Saudi and his relatives and those who are in line with King Abdullah, it's possible that it could be after him when they will have this ikhtilaf. Allah knows best. So when this ikhtilaf takes place, some people will approach Imam Mahdi, who will be in Medina, and say, you need to be the next Khalifa. What will happen? He will run away from Medina and he will travel all the way to Makkah al-Mukarramah. Why? Because he doesn't want any leadership. And look at our people. The brother becomes a toilet cleaner in the masjid and he starts giving his power and authority everywhere he goes. Somebody becomes a leader inside a masjid committee member and he starts showing his power and authority on the road as well. Brother, do this, brother, do that. Look at your state, look at your situation. You know, small little power and he starts doing his judgment on everybody. And some people, they don't want to do anything and they want to be leaders. And if you call these people chairman critics, they sit on the chair and they don't want to do anything. Imam Mahdi will run away. Why? Because he doesn't want anything to do with this. He will arrive in Makkah al-Mukarramah, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, when he arrives in Makkah, he will take refuge in a house, and whilst he's there, there will be 313 Muslims. From the best of the Muslims at that time, they will recognize Imam Mahdi and they will approach Imam Mahdi and they will say, we want you to be the leader, we want to take pledge on your hands. Imam Mahdi will say, look, I'm not fit for this. They will force and they will place their hands in the hands of Imam Mahdi and say, you are the Imam, you're the leader, now we want to do jihad under your leadership. And what is going to happen when this takes place? On the other side of the world, in Damascus, in Syria, there will be a man who will emerge. And this is a very, very critical part in the emergence of Imam Mahdi. His name will be Sufyani. And Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu mentions a hadith that this man will emerge from Damascus in Syria and he will kill anybody and everybody. He will rip the children out of the wombs of their mothers and he will kill women, slaughter women and have widespread massacre. A group from the Muslims, from the Banu Qais, a tribe, they will try and attack him, he will destroy everybody who is there. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, he will be from the Quraysh, and his name will be, he will give, be given a name as Sufyani, but his actual name will be Urwa. And what will he do when he hears that Imam Mahdi has arrived? Because he wants leadership, and because he wants to have power, he will know that if Imam Mahdi is here, my leadership will not work. So I have to kill Imam Mahdi. He will send an army, and in another narration, he will come as the leader of that army, and he will travel all to, from Damascus all the way to a land which is known as Baida, a barren land. And the narration mentioned it is just in front of Dhul Hulayfa, in front of Makkah al-Mukarramah, Dhul Hulayfa in that direction. When this army reaches this area, piece of land, what is going to happen? Imam Mahdi will be preparing for jihad. And because he will have so much less numbers and he will be ill-equipped, the Prophet ﷺ said that those will be Imam Mahdi 313, exact same number as those who participated in the Battle of Badr. And you know how great the people of Badr were? The Prophet ﷺ was approached by Jibreel ﷺ, and Jibreel ﷺ said to the Prophet ﷺ, "O Muhammad, tell me, what do you think of those who participated in Badr amongst the Sahaba? What is your opinion of them?" And the Prophet ﷺ said, "Hum afdaluna, they are the most virtuous amongst us." And you know the virtue of being a Badri Sahabi meant your past, present, future sins have all been forgiven by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Jibreel alayhi salam, when he asked this question, he said, "Oh Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, do you know those angels who descended on the day of Badr to help the Sahaba, they are the best angels from amongst us as well." So these 313 will help Imam Mahdi. They will have no weaponry, they will not be equipped. Like I mentioned, that man who entered Makkah in 1979, AK-47s, snipers on the minarets of the masjid, shooting people, killing people, this is not the job of Imam Mahdi. And Imam Mahdi will be ill-equipped, but he will have the help and assistance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when this army reaches the land of Baida, the first portion of that army, the earth will open and swallow and sink everybody inside that army. And this will be such an incident that the whole world will be talking about this. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, only one person who will be the informant, he will survive from that swallowing of the earth. He will run back to his people at his homeland and he will tell them what has happened. When this takes place, Imam Mahdi will become worldwide number one news. And what will happen? Thousands of people from Iraq, Sham, Syria, possibly from England as well, they will all travel to Makkah al-Mukarramah and they will give bayah in the hands of Imam Mahdi. When Imam Mahdi takes the pledge of allegiance from these people. Oh, 5 minutes left, subhanAllah. When Imam Mahdi takes pledge at the hands of these people, what will happen? Imam Mahdi will start sorting out the situation of the Muslim Ummah. And the ulama mentioned what Imam Mahdi will do. What will he do? He will sort out the bid'at and all those activities that the Muslims are involved in. He will remove the bid'at and the innovations inside the deen. He will start propagating the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He will purify the souls of people. And alongside this, as I mentioned yesterday as well, that what he will do, he is a mujahid, he will be a fighter. All those Muslims who are fighting in different parts of the land, and many brothers, they talk amongst themselves and say, why are the mujahideen fighting amongst themselves? Why is he doing this? Why is he doing that? What is happening with the issue of Kashmir? Personally, I believe this will only be resolved when Imam Mahdi will arrive. Nobody else will be able to solve this problem. So when Imam Mahdi arrives, all those leaders in different areas of the world who are fighting, they will all give their hands in pledge allegiance to Imam Mahdi. He will become the number one leader. Whatever he says, everybody else will follow. For 5 years he will carry on doing this, and thereafter, after 5 years, 6 years in another narration, in the 46th year in the life of Imam Mahdi, there will be a peace treaty between the Romans and the Persians. And the Muslims, they will fight alongside the Christians as well as the Jews and the Romans. And what will happen? A peace treaty will take place, but in a battle, some Muslim prisoners will be captured. And when these Muslim prisoners will be captured, the Christians will say, hand over the Muslims to us. And this is why part of our iman is, doesn't matter what that person is, if he's a Muslim, he's your Muslim brother. And the Muslims will say, wallahi la nukhalli baynana wa bayna ikhwanina. We can't hand over our Muslim prisoners to you. They are Muslims, they belong to us. The Christians will complain to the king, they will have a disagreement, and then they will prepare an army. According to a narration, 960,000 soldiers underneath approximately 80 flags who will fight against the Muslims, and Imam Mahdi will be in that army. One portion of that army will see the non-Muslims, they'll drop their weapons, turn around and run away. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never ever forgive these people. Second portion will go forward, they will fight, they will be martyred. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Afdalu shuhada inda Allah." They are the most virtuous of martyrs in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then the third category will go forward, they will fight, they will defeat the Christians, and what will happen? The booty, the mali ghanima, the booty will be given over to the Muslims, and they will start distributing the wealth amongst themselves. And thereafter, when this takes place, Imam Mahdi will be distributing the wealth, Shaitan will arrive and Shaitan will make an announcement and say, Dajjal has emerged. In the 47th or in the 48th year, he will say, Dajjal has emerged. And when he will make this announcement, Imam Mahdi, he will send some horsemen towards the destination of Shaitan where he mentioned. Either he will be Shaitan in its actual form or a human being in the form of a Shaitan. And he will go and send the horsemen. The Messenger of Allah said, I know the color, the types of horses that those riders will be riding, and I know the names of those men who will be sitting on those horses. Because he had this attachment with this masjid. This is part of your deen. A Muslim should only be scared when he talks about falsehood. If it is truth, a Muslim should never ever be scared in regard to this. If you are scared, that means you are ashamed of the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when this takes place, one minute. There's a lot more to talk about though. You know, I'll wrap it up inshallah. When this takes place, Imam Mahdi, what will he do? Imam Mahdi, he will send those horsemen, they will come back and the horsemen will say this claim was a lie and this is all false. And thereafter, another announcement will be made and Dajjal will emerge. Once Dajjal emerges, the Muslims and the fighters who are there, they will all travel to Ghouta, which is the headquarters in Damascus for the Muslims at that time. Some narrations mention Baitul Maqdis, Jerusalem, some mention in Syria as well, Damascus, some mention Ghouta. These are different headquarters for the Muslims at that time. And this actually goes to show that Palestine will actually be free through the barakah of Imam Mahdi as well. And when he will enter Ghouta, he will go inside the masjid, Isa alayhi salam will descend just Fajr time, he will come down the eastern minaret, and he will come inside the masjid, the iqama would have taken place, Imam Mahdi will go forward, and Isa alayhi salam, he will see Isa alayhi salam, and he will say to Isa, you go forward. Isa alayhi salam will say, no, inna ba'dakum ala ba'din umara. Some of you are leaders over others. Taklimatullahi bihazi ummah. This is an honor which Allah has given this ummah, that one person from this ummah is leading the salah, and behind him there is a Nabi and Prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. After leading the salah will finish, gates will be opened, and the Dajjal will be in front, waiting with his army. In a narration, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Yatba'u Dajjal sabaheena alfan min Yahud min Asfahan. 70,000 Jews from Asfahan. Where's Asfahan? It is present day Iran. And there is actually Asfahan, if you go there, there are actually more than 70,000 Jews at this moment. And they've actually prepared some silk shawls which they will wear when they see Dajjal arrive. And they will be following Dajjal. As soon as he sees Isa alayhi salam, he will start melting like salt melts in water. He'll turn around, run with his tail between his legs, and he'll run towards Palestine, Bab Lud, the gate of Lud. Isa alayhi salam will catch him up and he will kill him and slaughter him there. After this happens, Imam Mahdi will be in his 49th or 48th year, and both Isa alayhi salam and Imam Mahdi, they will travel to Medina Munawwara after this hard battle and these difficulties. They will go to Medina Munawwara. Isa alayhi salam will present his salam to the grave of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi salam, and in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi salam replied back to Isa alayhi salam. He will reply back to Isa alayhi salam, and thereafter in the 49th year, Imam Mahdi will pass away. So finishing off now, my brothers, where does that leave us? MashaAllah, we heard, we listened. Does that mean we go home and carry on watching our dramas, Portugal and Turkish dramas, and enjoy ourselves? No. Number one, physically and mentally we prepare for the army of Imam Mahdi. If we are not part of Imam Mahdi, the army of Imam Mahdi, we teach our children to be part of Imam Mahdi's army, inshallah. Everyone ready for this, inshallah? Inshallah. Number two, this doesn't mean that you start going out on the street with flags and saying, we are the army of Imam Mahdi. You know, just baby and you know, you go outside. Physically, mentally, we get prepared. Number two, teach our children. And number three, connect ourselves to the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Very, very important. You know, look, we have this mashallah beautiful masjid. Many, they have concern, they have the deen, we have so many activities going on. The masjids are mazloom. In this day and age, masjid is mazloom. It is oppressed. And how is it oppressed? We don't come and visit the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No connection whatsoever. MashaAllah, there's many youngsters here, alhamdulillah. We need to connect our youngsters, our elders, everybody in the community with the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Through these things, inshallah, we will develop the connection with the deen. And through this, inshallah, this will develop inside us the courage and the ability to stand up for the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Is everyone ready for this, inshallah? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept our gathering here today. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make this a means of attaining His eternal pleasure, inshallah. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all the tawfiq and ability that we live with Iman and Islam, we die with Iman and Islam, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala resurrect us again in the hereafter with Iman and Islam. Ameen wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillah rabbil alameen. وصلى الله تعالى على خير خلق محمد وعلى اله وصحبه اجمعين برحمتك يا رب العالمين.